Copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to Acts chapter 20, verses 26 and 27. Acts chapter 20, verses 26 and 27. Wherefore, because of such and such things, I take you to record this day. That I am pure from the blood of all men. I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For, because I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. The caption for this morning meditation is Counsel of God. All the teachings of God are called the counsel of God. Baptism is the counsel of God. Here Paul says, I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. Because I have not shunned away to declare unto you all the counsel of God. I have declared unto you all the counsel of God. What the Lord has given me, I have declared unto you. Last week, I strongly felt in my spirit, that I should share with this church some of the basic teachings I believe. What the Lord has given unto me, I have given unto the church. What the Lord has showed to us, what the Lord has made us believe, we have shared that with the church. So we have never shunned to declare what the Lord has revealed unto you, what is profitable unto me, what is profitable unto my wife, what is profitable unto our children, we have never shunned to declare that to the church. We never sought after, Paul was writing in the same passage, any gifts from you, not your money, not your kinds, only your love. We are debtors to your love. When I was reading that passage, with all humility, I thought about myself and my wife. We never, even in some corner of our thought, we never preach something just to receive a favor from anybody. We all love you. Probably many a time, there may be an accusation that I was very blunt, but there's a reason for it. The main reason, it is because of the prompting of the Holy Spirit. And because that message is needed for somebody in the church, may not be for everybody. When we preach to a congregation, Dr. Ravi Zacharias used to say, It is a multiplied opportunity to reach individuals. Though we are talking to a congregation, we are talking to the individuals. We are talking to the individuals. So it is the work of the Holy Spirit to talk to the individuals. It is only a multiplied opportunity to talk to the individuals. So we had never shunned anything which has been profitable to us to declare unto the church. This church, everybody in the church could confess that. We are very happy about it. We can even brag about it. That not for the favor of any man, we have shunned any doctrine or any teaching. My dear brother, my dear sister, very briefly, I may not be able to take more than 10 minutes, just 10 points, not even 10 minutes, I can't take more than 5 minutes for a point. I'm going to share with you 10 points, 10 counsels, which we declare unto you all these years. Nothing is new. It may be new for some newcomers. This is what we believe. These 10 points are not all inclusive. It's only concise. What the Spirit of the Lord burdened me last evening, I'm sharing this with you. Number one, just every point I love to spend some 5 or 10 minutes, 5 or 6 minutes. Number one, we stand for truth. We stand for truth. Truth cannot be changed. Truth is something that cannot be changed. Truth is the same in India, in America, in Africa. Truth is the same in the days of Paul, in the days of Sundaram, in the days of Robert. What Sundaram said was true, but it is not true for today. No, absolutely it's not truth. Truth cannot change because of culture. Truth cannot change because of geographical difference. Truth will be the same everywhere. 2 + 2 = 4 is the truth. In America, we can't say 2 + 2 = 5. In Africa, you can't say 2 + 2 = 3. And in India, you can't say 2 + 2 = nearly 4. 2 + 2 = 4. You got 2 apples in here and 2 apples there, put together, you'll have only 4 apples. When you take these two calcets, you can't get 3.5 apples or 5 apples. This is the truth. The Word of God is the truth. The Word of God is the truth. Jesus is the truth. The Bible is the truth. We want to stand on the truth. So just I show you one verse, you can make a note of it, Isaiah chapter 26 from verse 1 to 2. Isaiah chapter 26 from verse 1 to 2. In that day shall the song be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong city. Salvation will God appoint for walls and bulwarks, salvation. So open ye the gates, that the righteous nation which keepeth the truth may enter in. Others cannot enter in. Those who keep the truth only can enter in. And when we say truth, the revealed counsel of God to us. When the counsel of God is revealed to us, that is the truth. That is the truth. Mainly to understand the truth is the apostolic teaching. Jesus is the truth, His words are the truth. So we want to stand for the truth. If it is in the Bible and when it is revealed to us, we want to obey. And we have never shunned to declare that to the church, what is revealed unto us. So number one, I love to say, this church wants to stand for the truth, the revealed Word of God in the Bible, especially the apostolic teachings. Number two, we want to understand what is true religion, or we understand Christian life, or Christianity is only a lifestyle, is not just another religion. Christianity is not a mere religion with what I have noted down last evening. For me, Christianity is not a mere religion with rites and rituals. There are only two sacraments in Christianity. One is baptism in waters in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. One sacrament. And the another sacrament is the Lord's table. There's no other rites and rituals in Christianity. Christianity is not just with fastings and feastings. We have got some fasting days and some feasting days. As the Lord leads, we may appoint the church, we may appoint some fastings. Every week we have got love feast. We may have fastings and feastings. But Christianity is not based on fastings and feastings. It is not with festivals and celebrations. There is no calendared festivals and celebrations. That's not Christian, that's a religion. That's a religion. Every religion has got their own festivals. If they celebrate Deepavali, they say it's a Hindu. If they celebrate Ramzan, they say it's a Muslim. If they celebrate Christmas on the day of Sun God, they say it's a Christian. It's rubbish. Because you are worshipping the day of a Sun God, or you are remembering the birth of Easter and call it Easter, and you say, no, we remember the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we don't become Christians. For me, Christianity is not a religion. Somebody had a picture of Lakshmi. They remove the picture of Lakshmi and have the picture of Mary. They don't become Christians. These symbols don't make you Christians. They had a spear or a trishul. Now they throw it away and they keep a cross. Because of that, can we say they are Christians? No. Or by changing the name. For me, Christianity is not just a mere religion, it is a true religion, or it is the way of life. It is a lifestyle. Christianity is the lifestyle. What is that lifestyle? Very simple, love. Love. It's not Christmas. It's not cross. It's not crucifix. It's not the altar for Mary. Christianity is love, pure love, unfeigned love, not lust, not kadal. It is agapeo, a noble love. Two things, love God, love man God has created in His own image. That's all very simple. Love God and love man. Who is that man? Your father, your mother, your children, your neighbor, your friends, your well-wishers, passers-by, even your enemy, those who persecute you, those who curse you. Love them. How do we love them? Four things. Love them with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your might. Love God with all your mind, with all your might, with all your heart, with all your soul. Likewise, love others. In one word, the substance of the commandment, the essence of the commandment is love. To have an unfeigned love. If we cannot love even our own parents, if we cannot love our neighbors, and we say that Christians and we have got all the rites and rituals, the festivals, fastings, feastings, meaningless, and we understand Christianity is a lifestyle. Let me go to number three. You can make a note of these things. This is what I believe. This is the counsel I'll never shun away in declaring unto the people. Number three, for me Christianity, we should understand what godliness is. What is godliness? According to 1 Timothy 3:16, godliness is Word becoming flesh. Word becoming flesh, that is godliness. It is in the Bible, lie not. When I don't lie, the Word becomes flesh. I become godly. The Bible says, be not conformed to the fashions of the world. That is the Word, Logos. Be not conformed to the fashions of the world. That's Logos. When I don't conform to the fashions of the world, because of the renewing of mind, that Word has become my flesh. I become godly. The Bible says, love your wife as you love yourself. Love your wife as you love yourself. Or the Bible says, obey your husband as you obey the Lord. That the Bible says. It's a logos, it's a word in the Bible. That word is spirit. When that word becomes my life and your life, when I love my wife, when I love my wife as I love myself, that word becomes flesh. I'm godly. The word was with God. Love your wife as yourself. Where was that word? Where was that word? That word was with God. That word was with God. And God has sent that word. God has sent that word. We have seen that word. How can we see that word? When that word becomes flesh, we can see that word. Love your wife is a word. Where was that word? That word was in the beginning. Where was that word? That word was with God. God only spoke that word. It's God's word. That word was with God. And when that word can be seen, that word should become flesh. How can that word become flesh? When I love my wife, that word that was with God becomes flesh. I become godly. I become godly. More and more the word of God becomes flesh. With all humility tell you, we become God. We are one with His nature. God is revealed in the flesh. God is revealed in the flesh. Otherwise what happens? Devil is revealed in the flesh. Devil is not one with two horns, as in the Oneida advertisement, with a long tail. How can the devil be revealed? If God is not revealed in your flesh, devil is revealed. Angry, wrath, fighting, lies, adultery, lust, backbiting, blasphemy, murmuring, complaining. When all these things are revealed in your flesh, devil is revealed in your flesh. When the word of God is revealed in your flesh, God is revealed in your flesh. That's a very simple thing for us. This is what I understand godliness. I preach this is godliness. It has got a little more, but today I confine with this. Godliness is the word becoming flesh is godliness. Let me go quickly to number 4. What we understand by holiness. This is the holiness we also want to teach with you. Holiness has got 3 basic things. Separated from, set apart, sanctified unto. In an orderly way, you can also share this with others. What do we mean by holiness? A holy day, a holy place, a holy man, a holy nation, holy unto the Lord. What is holiness? Holiness means I don't smoke. Holiness means I don't drink. What is really holiness? Holiness is separated from anything that is common. Separated from anything that is common. Set apart for divine purpose. Sanctified unto. The simplest example or illustration is, I can say this. A vessel, maybe a cup, maybe even a tumbler. In a church they use for the Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper, the Lord's table. An ordinary tumbler. That tumbler is separated from all the other vessels. It is not kept with the vessels we use in the restroom. It is not even kept with the vessels we use in the kitchen. It is separated from all the other vessels, even a physical separation. Not only physical separation, that vessel is set apart only for the Lord's table. We don't use it for other purposes. When a guest comes, we may not give water or tea in that tumbler or that cup. We don't use it for any other common purpose. It is set apart for that divine purpose. Okay, now we have separated it from other vessels, we have set it apart for a divine purpose. Now we keep it clean. Last week we used it for communion, we are going to use it next month. So we don't allow that unclean. We keep it very clean, we wash it with soap water, we make it dry, keep it in a closed cupboard. Even in our church we are doing it. We want to see that it is as clean as possible. It is as clean as possible. Even they wipe it with a very soft cloth. So that is holiness. So you are separated from other people. Not physical separation, a spiritual separation. You cannot dress like others dress. You cannot fashion yourself as others fashion. Other teachers may dress like that. Other peers, other classmates may dress like that. This may be the trend of the day. But if that's not acceptable to your Christian principles, you're separated from others. Your dress will be different, your hairstyle will be different. It is not just an outward appearance. Outward appearance is a reflection of the inward man. Outward appearance is only the reflection of the inward man. It's a very simple thing. Nobody can dispute on it. Whether your hairstyle or the style of your blouse or shirt or pants or your outfittings, whatever it may be, it is only what your inner man desires. It's a very simple thing. You can say, no, I don't have any ill interest, bad interest, because it is the fashion of the day. You are separated from. When others can dress like that, I can't. Pastor Sundaramaya used to say this phrase, others can, you can't. Others can, you can't. So in every way, we are, even our own family, we are separated from. Others may watch a type of a movie. Even in your Christian circle, a man was studying in a very reputed Bible college in Calais. One day very painfully he said, when many of my college mates, those on the Bible college, so in the evening they used to go for a movie, they used to call him. They used to tease him because he was not going for a movie. They used to say, oh, there's nothing wrong in it. They are going to be the future prophets, pastors, evangelists. But he was different, separated from among the brethren. Even the Bible college, we need a separation. Not only separation, you set apart your life for the Lord's purpose. That's your holy. In your college, you are a student, you are a lecturer for divine purpose. In your business, you are a businessman to declare the glory of God. Housewife, to declare the glory of God. You have got a divine purpose on the earth. So separated from, set apart. Now when you live for that divine purpose, make yourself clean. Approve upright. Approve clear. Approve new man. Show yourself a clean person. That sanctification is very, very essential. That sanctification is very, very essential. And the holiness is a process. Holiness is a process. He that is holy, let him be holy still. In other words, every step you take towards heaven is a step away from the earth. So just imagine, this is the world, this is heaven. When I'm moving towards heaven, in other words, I'm moving away from the world. I cannot move to this destination. I cannot move closer to this destination without moving away from that destination. It's impossible. So for us, our understanding, and we are not shunned to declare this to the church, and thereby we are free from your blood. For me, holiness is separated from, set apart, and sanctified, and others may do, but I cannot. I cannot. It doesn't mean that I don't say we should not have a change. If the change is for better, it's good. If the change should not be for worse. My dear brother, my dear sister, very quickly I go, number 5. Please make a note of these things. Number 5. I call this righteousness. What we understand by righteousness. For me, righteousness is right standing with God. Right standing with God is a righteousness. The Greek word, what is translated for righteousness, is a literal meaning is equity. Equity. Our chartered accountant will understand that word equity better than we all can understand. Equity is not equality. In a simpler way, I try to explain what equity is. If I'm wrong, you correct it. Equity, suppose I got 10,000 rupees. I give to everybody equally 1,000 rupees to 10 people. It is equality. Equally I'm giving. A type of equality. Not exactly. But equity, somebody has got 2 shares, I give him 2,000. Somebody has got 3 shares, I give him 3,000. There are 5 people who have got only 1 share, I give each person 1,000. I've given somebody 2,000, somebody 3,000, I've given 5 people 1,000, I'm right or wrong? Have I given equally? No. Somebody I gave 2,000, somebody I gave 3,000, for another 5 people I gave only 1,000. So I haven't given them equally. But according to their share, somebody had 2 shares, somebody had 3 shares, 5 people had only 1 share. So according to their shares, I have distributed equally, and that is called equity. Am I right, sir? Okay. That is equity. Is a right standing with God. That word is equity. What is right for you, you do. It is not he is doing like this, he is doing like this. No, no. What the Lord wants you to do, you do. What the Lord wants you to do, you do. Oh, he has got a church for 25,000 people. He has got a church for 10,000 people. I got a church only for some hundreds. God wants to give this. Be true to what God wants you to do. Probably they may have some 25,000 people and they say 98% will not go to heaven. Instead of having 25,000 people and say 98% will not go to heaven, it is better that you can have 100 and say 100% will go to heaven. That is equity. That is equity. Out of 25,000, 100 may come to heaven. Here out of 100, 100 will go to heaven. Righteousness is not comparing with others. It's only comparing with God. This is God's stand. The best Bible example for righteousness is Abraham. God wants to bless Abraham through Sarah. God told him when he was 75 years old, nothing happened. When he was 85 years old, God reiterated, nothing happened. He married, he took Hagar, Ishmael was born and all. Now about 13 years have passed by. Now he's 99 years old. Again God says, I'll give a child through Sarah. Abraham laughed. Abraham says, Lord, let Ishmael live, that's enough for me. Don't be kidding. When I was 75 years old, you said something, nothing happened. When I was 85 years old, after 10 years also, you reminded me, nothing happened. After that, I have married Hagar, now I got a child, Ishmael. That fellow is about 10, 12 years old. Let this Ishmael live. This is Abraham's stand. When he was 99 years old, this is Abraham's stand. Let Ishmael live. And this is God's stand. You'll have a son through Sarah. You'll have a child through Sarah. Abraham could not believe it. Now Abraham has lost his potency. And not only Sarah was barren, but now her womb is also dead. So it's impossible for Abraham to have a child through Sarah. But God says you'll have a child through Sarah, and he will be your heir, not the son of this bondwoman. So God stand, Abraham stand, let Ishmael live. We don't know what happened. Suddenly, Abraham started thinking, believing that he will have a son through Sarah. He believed it. Sarah's womb is dead. He has lost his potency. He believed that he will have a child through Sarah. So God's stand and Abraham's stand became one that is counted unto his righteousness. That is counted unto his righteousness. When you do what the Lord wants you to do, it's not a question whether you are a pastor or a missionary or an evangelist, or a Sunday school teacher, are you doing what the Lord wants you to do? That is the right standing with the Lord. That is counted to your righteousness. That is counted to your righteousness. Number six. Can you just tell me what are the five things we have seen? Number one. Can somebody help me? Those who are noting down. Standing, our stand for truth. How do we understand what the truth is? Number two, Christianity is not a mere religion, it is our lifestyle. Number three, godliness. What do we understand by godliness? Word becoming flesh. Word becoming flesh. Number four, holiness. What we understand by holiness? Separated from, set apart, sanctified unto. Holiness is a process. Holiness is a process. Number five, righteousness, right standing with God. What is right for God is right for me. Number six, very, very important in these days. It is more than understood, it is misunderstood. Grace. Grace. So number six, understanding grace. I don't worry what others say. I'm worried what the Bible says. What the Lord has revealed unto me. I have not shunned in declaring that unto you, that I am free from your blood. Grace is not a license to lead a lawless life. Make a note of it. Share it with others. Grace is not a license to lead a lawless life. A lawless life. Today they talk about hyper grace, maybe super grace, I don't know. They talk about grace and they lead and they encourage people to lead a lawless life. A lawless life. We can live as we want. We can do anything what we are saved. We are free from law. They are lawless people. They are lawless people. They are not law-abiding people. They are against laws. They believe law is dead. They believe there is no law binding them. They are without law. They are lawless people. They are not law-abiding people. They are against law. They feel the law is dead. More than interpreting, corrupting the word of God, they turn people, become lawless. So many people love that, because generally we don't love law. So what is grace? Our understanding, we preach God's enablement in us to lead a life as God, our Creator, wants us to live. Grace is enablement in us. Grace enables us, makes us able. Grace is enablement in us to lead a life. It's not, this definition is not copied from anywhere. This is what I understand, I have put it in words. Grace is God's enablement in us to lead a life as God, our Creator, wants us to live. To fulfill God's laws and principles. God's laws and principles. The law says, don't lie. The law says, don't lie. I don't have the grace, I don't have the nature in me to obey the law. I lie. Now the law is not powerful to make me a person not to lie. The law says no, don't lie. But the law itself doesn't have power to make me not to lie. The law says honor your parents. The law says honor your parents. But in me, I don't have a nature to honor my parents. The law says honor your father and mother. But I don't have a nature to honor my father and mother. The law is unable to make me honor my parents. The law may say, I'll scourge you 40 times if you don't honor your father. Maybe out of the scourges, the whip, I may be scared and I may be obeying. But I don't have the nature to obey. But when the grace comes, the grace enables me to obey the law, to honor my parents. Now I got grace. Because I got grace, I fulfill the law. Because I got grace, I fulfill the law. Grace doesn't make me lawless. Law said honor your parents. Now I am free from law. So it means I don't need to honor my parents. Rubbish. Third-rate rubbish. Grace doesn't free you from law. Grace, who gave that law? Honor your parents. Who gave that law? God gave that law. So laws are God's mind. All the laws are God's mind. Not only honor your parents, honor the day of the Lord. Is it by Moses? Is it by Isaiah? Or is it by God the Father? Honor parents, you understand. Now this, and one more, honor the Lord's day. It is God's word. But the law is unable to make me honor the Lord's day. I want to go to my friend's place, I want to do this, I want to do that, I want to make only that day biryani, I want to make this, I want to make that, how to honor the Lord's day? I don't have the grace. Tomorrow I have to study for my exams, I have to go for this, go for that. But grace comes upon me, I honor the Lord's day. I fulfill the command, because that is the mind of God. All the laws are from God. All the laws are good. All the laws and principles there reveal the mind of God. So grace is an enablement. It's a power in you. It's a God-given shakti in you to fulfill the law, not to break the law. Jesus came not to break the law. Jesus came to fulfill the law. Jesus came to fulfill the law, not to break the law. Not to break the law. Can you say he gave the law and he broke the law? Many a time when we misunderstand the law, he showed what is adultery, what is lie, what is murder? What is mercy? What is honoring parents? He gave the right definition for the law which is misunderstood. He never broke the law. He never broke the law. He made people understand the law. He made people understand the law. On the Lord's Day, you don't do anything. The Lord's Day, you don't do anything. No miracle. He said, understand the law better. If your donkey has fallen into a pit on the Lord's day, you're lifting it up. You're lifting it up. Now she is the daughter of Abraham. She has got a demon possessed. I heal her. So it is not wrong in the Lord's day. It doesn't mean breaking the Lord's day. He didn't say break the Lord's day. He understood what is keeping the Lord's day. What is keeping the Lord's day? It is a ill will teaching. It's a demonic teaching to say the laws are abolished. It is misinterpreting Paul. Now I don't have time to get into it because it's a very important thing. Now, the hypergrace teaching is very much spreading all over. It is 200 years back, a prophet said, when will the coming of Jesus be? He said, when a day comes when they say that you can sin because you have got grace. Sin is no problem because you have got grace. That is the last teaching before the coming of the Lord. 200 years back when saint has said this. So it is for the fulfillment of the prophets this erroneous teaching has come. The Jews, the Old Testament laws, life principles, Jews have enumerated as 613 laws. 613 laws. In 613 laws, they say 365 is negative and 248 as positive. What do you mean by 365 negative? Say, for example, 10 commandments. There are honor your father and mother. It's positive. Remember the Lord's Day, positive. Steal not, negative. Murder not, negative. Be not covetous, negative. Don't worship other gods, negative. Honor your parents, positive. Like that, there are 365 negative commandments and 248 positive commandments. All these 613 commandments, I divided into three major categories. You can make a note of it. Three major categories. Number one is hygiene, laws of hygiene. What you can eat, what you should not eat, what is good for your body, what is not good for your body, how to keep your body clean, how to have a family life, what you should do after the childbirth, etc., etc., etc. They all are related with your hygiene. So those laws, any human being must be able to follow. It's good for their health. Now today, not as a law, because of the other development, scientific developments, your level of hygiene, you may know how you should behave. But the basic concept of hygiene is the same. The basic concept of hygiene is the same. It is only to protect our health, protect the health of the community. They all were in the wilderness, they all were staying together, they all have to answer the nature together. They all have to breathe the same air, they all have to drink the same water. So for the benefit of an individual, for the benefit of a family, for the benefit of the community, after the childbirth, how many days of rest is needed, etc., etc. So all those laws are based on our own hygiene. It is better to follow those laws, not as letters, but as required. And number two, moral laws, civic moral laws. Any country, any nation must follow those laws. You can't say you got grace to break those laws. Because Christ has come, those laws are abolished. Murder not. Steal not. Honor your parents. Supporting the church which is leading you in the path of righteousness, teaching God's principles. Supporting that tabernacle, that holy place, that sanctuary, and the Levites. These are your civic responsibility. It's a moral law. Even without these laws, when a Hindu priest can show that murti with a deepam, they put that offering on that plate. For showing that murti with a deepam, a man has got a common sense to put an offering. When somebody is showing the way to heaven, Bible principles, praying for your family, a church, a place, it is a common sense, you have to meet the needs. So whether tithings or honoring parents, don't murder, don't steal, don't be covetous about other servants, don't be covetous about other things, they are all for your common living. What is wrong in it? Can you say those laws are not necessary? Now we are unable to do it. We are unable to do it. Law is unable to make us do it. Now God has given me the grace that I am able to fulfill the law, the moral laws, civic moral laws. I honored my parents till the end. I fulfilled that law. My dear brother, my dear sister, Number three, ceremonial laws. They are called Levitical laws. These festivals, the sacrifices, the ceremonial laws. All these ceremonial laws are very important. They all were symbolic shadows of the substance. Substance is Jesus Christ. So for their sin offering, for their remission of sins, they must offer a sacrifice. That's the law. Now it is not abolished. The substance, God offered Himself as a sin offering for me, and I believe that. This is fulfilled for my transgression. Not only for my sin, for my peace. An offering must be made to make me atone, for my atonement, to make me one with the Lord. So all these ceremonial laws, they all were symbolic, and all those ceremonial laws must be fulfilled in all its substance in the New Testament in our life. So the laws of hygiene is for everybody. Moral civic laws are for everybody. Ceremonial laws are for everybody. Ceremonial laws are everybody. My sins must be forgiven. My transgression must be forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ. So these ceremonial laws, I don't do it as a ceremony because the substance is fulfilled. No more I live in the shadow. Now I come into the substance. My dear brother, my dear sister. So grace is given to me to fulfill all these laws in my life. To fulfill all these laws in my life. I just show one passage to you about a very solid passage. If anybody talks to you about hyper grace, you can show them this passage. Titus chapter 2 verse 11 down. Verse 11 down. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation. Only grace of God brings salvation, not a work of law. It's only the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. This grace is not only for Christians, it's not only for Jews, it appeared unto all men, teaching us. This grace teaches us. It teaches us three things. Number one, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust. Number one, it teaches us say no to ungodliness. If it is not godly, say no. Say no to it. This is the teaching of grace, instruction of grace. Worldly lust. This way of dressing, that way of dressing, this fashion, that fashion. Is it a worldly lust? If you have got the grace, grace will tell you, deny it. This fashion, deny it. This style, deny it. These leggings, deny it. Wearing your trousers, showing your briefs, deny it. Dirty. It will teach you. Then you are a person with grace. Suppose you are unable to resist the fashions of the world. All my friends are wearing like that, mommy. What is wrong is this pastor has got chapa always like this. Then you don't have grace. That's a very simple thing. You want to conform to the fashions of the world. You are unable to say no to it because you don't have grace. You are not allowing the word to become flesh because you don't have the grace. If you have got grace, for worldliness you will say no. For ungodliness you will say no. Deny means you will say easily no. You won't find it difficult to resist that. That is the sign that you have got grace. So number one, denying ungodliness and worldly lust. Number two, that we should live soberly, righteously and godly in this present world. To live soberly. Why I dress like this? Why I wear jewels? Why I don't wear jewels? Why do I wear jewels? Why I don't wear jewels? Be sober. You must have a reason why you are wearing jewels. You must have a reason why you don't wear jewels. If somebody says, I don't wear jewels because in our church nobody wears jewels, it's not grace. Somebody says, I wear jewels because everybody wears jewels, that's not grace. I wear jewels because I want to glorify God. I have removed jewels because I have got glorified God. I live soberly. Because of such and such word, I removed my jewels. You are sober. Many times when we don't know why we do this, we are not sober. Live soberly. Why don't you lie? Why don't you dress like others? Why don't you behave like others? Why don't you lie? Why don't you lie? Just a small customary lie. Really, I am proud of our believers. Just a small customary lies. Some of our believers in a situation, they have to accept a customary lie. Literally, they broke. How can we lie like this? But any common person, they'll say, oh, there's nothing in it. That is all. Why? These people have got grace. They want to live soberly. They want to live righteously. They want to live godly. In my college, in my school, in my work spot, in my business, I want to be righteous. I want to be godly. So they got the grace. So grace will teach us to say no to ungodliness and worldly lust. Grace will make us live soberly, righteously and godly in this present world. Number three, grace will teach us looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ. How do I know that a person has got grace? It's not because they are just dancing. It's not because you have got a big church that 20,000 people can be seated. When I see, they are always looking forward to the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. That church is filled with grace. When he goes to bed, Lord, if you come this night. When he gets up in the morning, Lord, if you come today, keep me ready for that. That person is a person with the grace. That person is a person with a grace. So if anybody has got grace, they'll have this identity. They'll say no to worldliness and ungodliness. They'll live soberly, righteously and godly. Number three, they'll always be looking forward to the glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. They are the people with the grace. That is the work of grace in our life. Grace is not a license to lead a lawless life. It's very, very important in these days. Number seven. This is the counsel of God we share with the church. We believe it. Teaching on the Lord's Day. Many people say there's nothing called Lord's Day in the New Testament and all. In the Ten Commandments, you cannot say that we want to take only the nine commandments and we don't want to obey the only one commandment about the Lord's Day. Either you have to accept all the ten or you can shun away all the ten. But you can't say, I don't accept only one. That's only for the Old Testament. No. It's for all generations. And even when Moses was giving the law, he was going back to creation. Creation is not only for Jews. All nations are created in him. It is on the same procedure. So it's not a Jewish commandment. It starts with the creation, the record of creation. That's not only for Jews. He quotes the creation. He quotes that creation. So it is nothing to do with the Jews. And if you see the human beings, all nations, in most of the religions, to the best of my knowledge, in all religions, it is a human constitution to set apart one day for a holy convocation, holy communion, coming together. All 6 days in a week they worship their God in their houses. They do all the pujas. But one day, it is a mandatory for them to go to the temple. Once in 7 days, they go to the temple. Muslim, once in 7 days, he goes to the mosque. Jews, once in 7 days, they go to the synagogue. It is a constitution. It's a period. It's something not only for Jews, it's something God ordained. In your life cycle, there are certain things we do once in a day. There are certain things we do 3 times a day. There are certain things we do once in a month. It is once in a week you set apart for your holy worship. It is in mankind in all religions. In other words, it is in man. It's nothing to do with Jews, Muslims or Hindus. Once in 7 days. That once in 7 days cycle. My dear brother, my dear sister, that's made for us. That's made for us. That day of rest, that day of Sabbath is a cycle made for us. And how to observe that day? I just take a Bible principle. Isaiah 58 verses 13 and 14. Isaiah 58 verses 13 and 14. If thou turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable, and shalt honor him, not doing thine own ways, not finding thine own pleasure, not speaking thine own words, then shalt thou delight thyself in the Lord, and I will cause thee to ride upon the high places of the earth, and feed thee with the heritage of Jacob thy father. The latter part, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. For the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. 3 parts. Number one, in your mindset, remember it is the Lord's day. It is a holy day, not a holiday. It is an honorable day. It is a day of glory. 4 things it must be in your mind. It is a holy day, honorable day, Lord's day, day of glory. It should be in your mindset. Set apart that day for divine purpose. Not going anywhere that I want to go. Not doing anything that I want to do. Not speaking anything what I want to speak. Set apart that day for a divine purpose. Go to a place to do divine purpose. Do something to do divine purpose. Talk something for the divine purpose. Set apart one day. He says, do your work all the 6 days. Do your work all the 6 days. You make your biryani. You make your wash your clothes. You go and see your auntie. Do all the 6 days. Don't treat the 7th day as a holiday. Treat this as a holy day. He doesn't say don't make biryani. You're unable to make biryani all the 6 days, so let me make biryani on the 7th day. So you, in your mind, the seventh day is a holiday. So early morning you want to go and put attendance in the church. Many churches, 5 to 7, full crowd. Because the whole day is free for them. They can go to MGM, they can go to some beach, they can go to friend's place, they can sit and watch some latest movies. The whole day is with them. And also that's the only day they get time to fight. Husband and wife to fight, children to fight. Probably they say that's why it is called Sunday. எங்க ஞாயிற்றுக்கிழமை சண்டை போடுறீங்கன்னா சொல்கிறாங்க, எங்களுக்கு வேறு நேரமே கிடைக்கலங்கிறாங்க. அந்த சண்டை எப்படி ஆரம்பிக்கணும்னா, இன்னைக்கு தாங்க கொஞ்சம் பேசுறதுக்கு டைம் இருக்கு, ரெண்டு பேரும் உட்காந்து பேசுவாங்க, நிறைய அவங்ககிட்ட பேச நிறைய பேச வேண்டியிருக்குன்னு சொன்னாலே சண்டை ரெடியாக இருக்குன்னு அர்த்தம். அப்புறம் இந்த பேப்பரில் போடுவாங்க, பேச்சுவார்த்தை தோல்வி அடைந்தது, பேச்சுவார்த்தை தோல்வியில் முடிந்தது. ஒரு நாள் பேசினதுக்குங்க அநியாயம், அடுத்த 6 நாள் பேச மாட்டாங்க. அடுத்த 6 நாள் பேச மாட்டாங்க. காஃபி பஸ் காசு இப்படிதான் ஓடும். 6 நாள் இப்படி 7வது நாள் கோயிலுக்கு போனோம்னா காம்ப்ரமைஸ். வீட்டில் சும்மா இருக்கும்போது காம்ப்ரமைஸ் சண்டேயில் முடிஞ்சிடும். அடுத்த 6 நாள் பேச மாட்டோம். அடுத்தன்னு treat this as a holy day. 3 blessings. Number 1, the Lord will make you delight. You'll be happy. He has done it in my life. He makes me delight. He makes our family delight. Number 2, He'll make you ride on the high places of the earth. All Sundays we set apart for the Lord's purpose. In my studies, God blessed me. The studies of our children, God bless them. He made us ride on the high places of the earth. Before my public examination, I didn't even touch my books. The Lord gave me a university rank. He did it that to my children also, our children also. So number three, He will feed you with the heritage of your father Jacob. The Bible promises what is given for Israel, what is given for Jacob, I'll make you the head, not the tail, etc., etc., etc. All those blessings, what is given for our father Jacob, they will become our heritage. Otherwise, we don't have any right to enjoy the promises given to Jacob. It's a promise given to Jacob and the children of Jacob. How can I enjoy the promise of Jacob when I obey the Lord's day? When I obey the commandment, as I become the children of Abraham by faith, I become the children of Jacob when I obey God's Lord's day. So I don't want to get into the details already, I'm running out of time. Number 8, the teaching of tithing. This is the main reason why we took it today. A few days back, one brother was talking to me about the tithing, and I felt strongly, he was very enthusiastic. I felt strongly that I should remind this to the church. I don't have time to go through it. Earlier I have preached 2 sermons. One is opening the windows of heaven. Vanathin Pandagasalagale Tharandhu. The other one, tithing, the Bible principle. Tasamapaham Vedahama Kotpadugalum. Those CDs would be available at the big bookstore. And also I request our media people last night to have that audio file ready for here on program project also. Probably they would have done it. So at the close of the service you can have that. The best way to maintain an equity in the church, the tithing alone. I don't have time to explain that in detail now because I'm fighting against time. Tithing, how it is make equal. So somebody gives 10,000. Somebody gives 10 rupees. That's a partiality. One has got a lot of money, he gives 10,000. Oh, he's a big man. He has given 10,000. Oh, he has given 1 lakh. There's another poor man. He has given only 10,000. Oh, you sit there. You're given only 10 rupees. You sit there. Only 100 rupees. Oh, he has given 1 lakh. In our church, everybody is equal because of the equity. One who has got a profit of 1 lakh, he gives 10,000. So he gives 10%. One whose salary is 10,000, he gives 1,000. He also gives 10%. One who has got 10,000, he gives 1,000. One who has got 10 lakhs, he brings 1 lakh. See, in our church, everybody is equal. It's not a question whether he has given 1 lakh or he has given 100 rupees. It's a question, he has given 10%, he has given 10%. There is no other way to bring equity in a church. Everybody is equal in the church because everybody is giving only 10% according to the blessing they get. So everybody is equal in our church because everybody is giving only 10%. That is to support the church. And with their blessings, from those 90%, they can support the poor, they can support the other ministries. They can support the poor, they can support other ministries. It is left to them. It's what they do. But this is giving to the Lord. When you help a poor, you make God a debtor and He will return that. But when you pay tithe, you honor God and He will return not what you have paid, He will return it many a fold. If you want to know more about the teaching of tithing, you can just collect that CD and get into that. But in our church, we believe that as a best Bible principle, to have an equity in the church. Number 9, that our stand on jewelry and external adornment. For that also I knew that I wanted time to explain, so I said we have got a message on that, a seminar we had for 6 hours, and it was a 4-hour message. Again, it was reduced, I think, to 2 or 3 hours. You can listen to that message and you can understand what is our stand. How do you understand the counsel of God from the Bible? My dear brother, my dear sister, wearing jewelry, we don't say a sin. We don't say it's a mandatory for salvation or baptism. And God can fill people with the Holy Spirit. Wearing jewels, we don't say that you should not remove jewels for baptism. But we know very well, as we draw closer to the Lord, when the Spirit of the Lord works in us, because of the renewing of our mind, our outward change takes place. And a very simple fitting example, there's the two principles, having idol in our body or using our body as idolatry. Number 2, adorning our body. There are 2 things, I don't know, have time for that. You can also collect that CD for that. But I tell you, in our stand is a very simple story. The story always, I love that. Once one father said, I'll take you for this summer to Darjeeling or Kodaikanal. Say Kodaikanal. I take you all to Kodaikanal. Something in between the children did that the father did like it. Father didn't like it. So the father said, I don't like you have done this. I don't like you have done this. So I don't want to go with you. I will be upset. If I go with you, I will be upset. All through the journey, I will be upset. Not only I will be upset, I will also make you unhappy. I will be upset and I will also make you unhappy. So I won't go with you. But I send a car, I give the car, I'll send a driver. You all go enjoy and come. You all go enjoy and come. To understand jewelry, this is a fitting story. Immediately the children, hey, Appa is not coming, Appa is not coming, we will go. Appa says we will go. Appa said that he will send us to Kodaikanal. Appa said he will send that car, give the car and the drive. Hey, Appa is not coming, happy, happy. As long as he doesn't come, we are happy. That is one reaction. Another reaction, Daddy. No, Daddy, we will not do it. We will not do it. If you are not happy with this, no, Daddy, we will do what you do. Please, you must come. We don't go to Kodaikanal unless you come. That is another set of children. This is what exactly the teachings of jewelry. At Oreb, when these people wore jewels, God said to Moses, I don't like it. I don't like it. If I go with you, I will kill you. But I don't want to do it. I will send an angel to you. He will take you to the promised land. I will not go with you. When they heard these words, he didn't say, I will not give you Canaan. He didn't say, I will destroy you right now. He didn't say, no, you won't go to the promised land. You people are wearing jewels. No, you won't go. He didn't say that. He said, I'm not happy with this. Hearing this, we read in Exodus chapter 33, they removed jewels. We don't want to do anything that could displease our Father. We don't want to do anything that could displease our Father. They said, unless you come, we will not go. So the Bible says, it is there, there is. So the story behind it, it is not a sin. So in our church also, we love the people wearing jewels. There are different reasons. For some people it is more cultural. For some people they don't have a deeper teaching. Some people they may not get enough grace. It takes in the process. If it's not today, tomorrow. For some people the changes, they don't adorn themselves with jewels. Only one chain. They don't feel it is wrong. They might even remove their ear stud. Or they remove chain, bangle, just only one ear stud. Because that hole is there. They get every reason. But as they come closer and closer to God, if it is not today, tomorrow the change will come. We love people wearing with jewels. We don't hate them. We pray for them. But our sincere desire, they must also come into the grace that is given unto us. So it is not like murdering or stealing. It is not counted with that. It is not counted with that. He that is holy, let him be holy still. He that is holy, let him be holy still. But certainly in the Bible, adorning ourselves with jewelry is sin, it's forbidden. It is sin, it is forbidden. For you to have a better understanding on this, I encourage you to collect these two CDs, one on tithing, one on jewelry. And if you got those CDs, please go through that. And finally, about rapture, apocalypse. The 10th one, with this I conclude. There are different teachings on the rapture. I give three Bible passages. God willing, I'll speak on that exclusively later. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 to 54, five verses. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 to 54. And number 2, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 to 18, six verses. From verse 13 to 18. And number 3, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, from verse 1 to 10. From verse 1 to 10, we strongly believe in that in our church. I believe it. I take it as the counsel of God. I am not shunned away from declaring that unto you. There is a day when the church would be raptured. The mortality shall put on immortality. Those who are dead in Christ shall rise first, and those who remain alive and remain will be caught up together with them to be in the Lord. It is appointed unto man once to die and then judgment, but it's a mystery, we will not die. Without seeing death, our vile body will be changed unto his glorious body. Without seeing death, death will be swallowed up by life. We strongly believe a day of rapture. Our body will be raptured. Our vile body will be transformed into a glorious body. So we have to be very careful about the totality of our holiness. Holiness in the spirit, holiness in the soul, holiness in your body. Physical holiness is very, very important. In these last days, there are variations and differences. But we strongly believe this. And we declare this unto the church, and we again strongly believe you are here, you are with us, because you also got the grace that is given to us. So the teachings, what we thought it is profitable to us spiritually, we share this with you. We don't want to hide it from you. We don't want to preach something to get you a favor. We are just given the pure word of God. Obey the word of God, take the counsel of God, surely it will be a blessing for you, shall we pray.